Hey, I'm Becky, and I'm here with my friend Emily Grassley from the Brain Scoop channel. We're doing an epic collab. It's an urban habitat rat diorama. We're going to use our sculpting skills and Emily's taxidermy and painting skills. So stick around for the details on the electronics, which is my major contribution, and go over to her channel to see me skin a rat for the first time and all the gross stuff. And I'm super excited to work with you on this.
Yeah, I'm super excited to be here. This is a project long time coming.
If my viewers don't already know you, which would be a little sus, but I'm sure there are some of them, could you tell us about what your channel's like?
My name is Emily Grassley. My channel, The Brain Scoop, we focus a lot on natural history, science, and museums. So I love to talk about the history of natural history museums, dioramas being a major part of it, and I've always wanted to make one myself. So I'm super excited to be here and to bring some of my viewers along to teach them about the things that I cannot do, like the electronics and the making. I'm really excited to work with you on this.
Yay! I've been an OG Brain Scoop fan since like 2013, so.
Oh, yeah.
You know. So the first thing that we did was sketch out our diorama and figure out how big it needed to be, or more appropriately, how small it needed to be to fit up the spiral staircase to your studio. And also generally like live inside a house versus
a museum.
I brought a bunch of scrap plywood with me because like we're not buying a new sheet of plywood unless we absolutely need to.
Right.
And we roughed out a cut list based on some dimensions that we gleaned from both the maximum size of the thing we can get up the stairs and also the ratios for the scene that we want to make.
Yeah. Yeah, because we're not scaling this really. The rats are full size, so it's not like we're shrinking anything down. So we have to fit effectively like a small, low profile image and basically like at street level for these rats. And so we have to try and capture all the details of that kind of scene in a 2x3 foot area.
So we did sketch out, here's our actual sketch. We were sketching out like our foreground elements, our background elements. I had learned from you that dioramas in history museums like this normally have like a curved background in order to be able to paint like a horizon line. And we have like a big brick wall in mind for like a corner of a building. And so we've decided to do like a curve on one side. And from our sketches, we were able to make a cut list of the pieces of plywood that we needed to construct the sides, the floor, and the back.
For this project, I was squarely in charge of any electronic elements going into our diorama. We brainstormed a steam feature, so I got to work on that first. I basically turned an old disposable vape into a mini fog machine. I hooked it up to an air pump using bits of silicone tubing, and since these things are activated by negative air pressure from the user inhaling through it, the pump can do the same thing. I picked up some flavorless 0% nicotine e-juice and used it to refill the spent vapes I got from a friend. I had to drill out the mouthpiece a bit for the tubing to fit, and then I used silicone adhesive to make an airtight seal. The thing is, just because these things were quote-unquote empty doesn't mean they don't still stink. I wrote a simple Arduino program to activate the pump for a few seconds every minute, simulating a human user, with the exit tube out the window to flush out the stinky vape juice left in the sponge. I soldered wires onto the pump to make the connections more permanent. Then this setup was the first thing I mounted to my control board, which is just a piece of plywood I set upright in my vise, with a plan to install it inside the diorama later. I used bits of nylon strapping and some screws to secure the pump to the wood. The relative positioning of the vape device and the pump matters because of the condensation that forms in the tube. And the vape works best upright, so I wanted to figure out a way to mount it and a few backups just below the pump. I could have used more strapping, but wanted to make them easily removable for refilling, so I 3D printed a little holder and mounted it and a power strip to the board as well. At this point, I figured out that one of my vapes could operate while charging, so I just kept it plugged in. Usually they can't charge and run at the same time, and the others in this set certainly don't. I wanted to try to make my rat hold a tiny flashlight, so I modeled one in Tinkercad, my favorite 3D modeling software, and printed it out in gray PLA filament on my 3D printer. A single 5mm LED fits inside, and the wires come out a hole in the handle. The wires from the flashlight, the air pump transistor circuit, and LED strip all converge on the control board, where an Arduino Uno and solderless breadboard host all the connections. Once everything was working, I made a new, more permanent circuit using a solder full breadboard. I made ID tags for each one with my label maker. Just like all my projects, I've published a complete guide at the link in the description with a supplies list, step-by-step instructions, and code. You can get all the parts and tools for this project at DigiKey, the sponsor of this video. To Emily's and my pleasant surprise, they carry a bunch of crossover tools that work for taxidermy too, like scalpel blades and small scissors, and they ship super fast. And if you're new to electronics, I've got an intro series on the DigiKey channel that will gently introduce you to all the tech skills you'll need to build a project like this rat diorama. Big thanks to DigiKey for their continued support of my channel. One of the best ways you can support me is to shop with my sponsors. In the days and weeks leading up to my trip, I couldn't help but start collecting some authentic city trash for our diorama. I also shellacked some pizza crust in case we want to depict our taxidermy rats having a snack. We loaded up the van with the in-progress parts and drove to Emily's place in Chicago. There, we built the plywood box that will contain the diorama. Then, we spent the next day at the Peggy Notbart Nature Museum learning how to prepare the rat specimens for taxidermy. This was an entirely new experience for me. Emily's friend and fellow YouTuber Rob Scallon also joined us at the museum, where Rob Kelsey taught us to skin and flesh out our rats. Go over to Emily's channel to watch the full gory process. And if you came here from Emily's channel, I've got a playlist of my videos curated just for you. I hope you'll check it out and subscribe to my channel. The plywood box needed to have an opening at the back for installing the electronics, and its floor needed to be elevated from the bottom edge so that forms could be fixtured from the underside. Basically, you need to be able to get your hands under it. We used scrap plywood and pocket holes to make our basic shape. Then used a thinner piece of plywood to create a curved backdrop that Emily would later paint. Our diorama centerpiece is the corner of a brick building, so I carved bricks from some foam insulation, then textured them with a piece of aluminum foil, which is a trick I picked up from Nerdforge. When I wanted to make a double height block for the concrete footer, I used air dry clay to fill in the gaps. Emily painted the bricks. The next morning, we installed the control board in the back corner of the box. Then I cut a hole for the dryer vent cover and we installed the brick wall into the diorama box. I used a plastic sandwich bag to act as a funnel for the water vapor by taping the silicone tube into one corner. The bag is squished in the space between the vent and the foam. I think it came out great. I also added some pixel strips to the upper edge for some simulated city lighting. We used an app called Polycam to 3D scan our rats' heads so we could then 3D print them to use inside the taxidermy. We've heard that sculpting the face is one of the more challenging parts of mammal taxidermy, so hopefully this would give us a leg up. The process involved putting the heads on wires so that I could move my phone all the way around it to capture images for the photogrammetry. I left Chicago with a rat skin and a bunch of files. Besides the technology we're using for the head, I made the rest of the form the old-fashioned way, using some stiff wire wrapped in slightly dampened wood wool, held in place with strong thread. This is where the tracings and reference photo of the carcass would be useful, but I didn't have those for this particular skin, which was prepared ahead of time so we could cooking show everything during the limited time of my visit. This, like many skills, takes practice to get good at, so please be gentle with your feedback as this is my first time. We're following Alice Markham's tutorials. She's a super expert who makes pieces for museums, so I highly recommend taking one of her classes and appreciate her sharing resources with us to get started with this fun and very strange hobby. Something I figured out along the way is the flashlight I want my rat to hold can't be assembled before wiring up the form. We want the hole for the flashlight wires to be as small as possible, so I added the wires to the form first. To see how we got to this point with our rats,
With the help of our kind hosts at the Peggy Notebart Nature Museum, head over to Emily's channel, The Brain Scoop, and subscribe to catch the finished diorama video over on her channel as soon as it comes out.
Becky, thank you. I learned so much.
Me too. Oh my gosh, this was so fun. So make sure you watch the video on Emily's channel. Most of you are probably here from there, which is super cool. I also made a playlist for those of you who are coming here from Emily's channel to show you the best stuff that I got that I think you'd like. And this was so fun, and it'll be one of my favorite videos ever, I'm sure.
Yeah, I can't wait. I can't wait to see it all come together.
Bye.
This video was made with support from my sponsors and generous donations from viewers like you through Patreon and YouTube memberships.